Hi, my name is Vincent Van Buren, and this video is about basic study designs. The gold standard of study designs is the randomized controlled trial. In a randomized controlled trial, investigators control the independent variable of interest, and investigators assign subjects to different treatment groups randomly. Proper randomization is important. The proper way to randomize subjects is by using random number assignment to each subject. And let's look at a situation where this is important. Suppose you're using rats in a study and think that you are pulling out half of them at random to put in one group. The question is, was it really random, or did you grab the rats that were easiest to catch? Maybe the rats that are easy to catch will have a different physiology from the rats that are harder to catch. That would introduce a potential bias in your study. The same idea of rat selection above applies to many situations where groups are seemingly assigned randomly, but have a hidden bias. The only way to be sure that you are not introducing some bias is to use random number assignment to make groups. This graph shows a depiction of how a randomized controlled trial is organized. So, you have a group of individuals that you will divide into treatment groups and untreated, and the assignment occurs randomly. So the two things that are important here are, one, that membership in the treated group and untreated group is randomly selected from the original cohort of subjects, and the investigator controls the treatments. Following treatment, the subjects are then evaluated for the presence of the disease or other outcome of interest. Then the number of people with the outcome of interest in the treated group, or the proportion of those people, can be compared with the proportion of people with the outcome of interest in the untreated group. And then we can make an assertion of causality. If there's a difference that we detect, we can attribute that difference to the treatment given to the subjects. This is an example of an experimental study where we look forward from our original grouping of individuals. Let's compare this to a cohort study. In a cohort study, the investigator does not assign group membership in a random way. And we simply look for whether those with those unexposed to a risk factor and those exposed to a risk factor have a different outcome with respect to a disease. But the investigator does not control that exposure to the risk factor. And finally, for our hypothesis-driven studies, we have a case control study. In a case control study, we look backwards in time. So we start out with individuals that have the disease or outcome of interest, and we identify other individuals that don't have that disease but are otherwise similar to the distribution of other influential factors. So in other words, we look for groupings of people that may be of similar age, similar race composition, similar gender composition, and so on. All those factors which may affect the likelihood of having a given disease. And we try to match those against the cases of those people that do have the disease. Then we look backwards in time and look for the exposures that we're interested in. So, for example, we may have an interest in how exposure to smoking influences the likelihood of having lung cancer. So we may start with a group of patients that have lung cancer, a group of patients that don't but are otherwise similar, and look back at their smoking histories and see how many of those people in each group were exposed to smoking and unexposed to smoking. And then we can evaluate whether there was a difference in exposures. Here we show the relative strengths of these different basic study designs. So the randomized controlled trial, as I said, is considered the gold standard, and its main benefit is that we can make strong causal inferences from the randomized controlled trial by both controlling for possible biases and controlling the exposures or the treatments. We have a good confidence that the outcomes are meaningful causal inferences. The cohort study is the next strongest type of study. We can make causal inferences with this type of study, but it's less reliable than the randomized controlled trial. And finally, the case control study, where we can only measure associations of exposures and outcomes. We can't draw causal inferences. In general, the more a cohort study or a case control study follows the principles of good randomized controlled design, the better. If randomized controlled trial experiments are the gold standard, why are cohort and case control studies performed? Ethical considerations prevent investigators from exposing human subjects to known harmful agents or procedures. So we can't always do randomized controlled trials because that would imply that we are exposing patients to something that we know may be harmful. Retrospective cohort and case control studies are often conducted because leveraging existing data is frequently powerful and a cost-effective approach. So another reason for doing cohort and case control studies is that they are more accessible. It's easier to get one started, and we can use existing data in many cases. Cohort studies are not good for rare diseases, but case control studies are a good choice for studying rare diseases. So if we reflect back on the way that a cohort study is organized, we start out with a population and then look forward in time to see what the outcomes were. If the disease is rare, it may be that the pool of subjects that we have isn't large enough to obtain anyone with a disease. So that would be a very poor study design. However, if we are using case control, we are starting with known cases of the disease and matched controls. So in those cases, we start out with a reasonable number of subjects to conduct the study, and then we look backwards in time. So implications of study design for computing relative risk. This chart summarizes some of the things that we've talked about already and also discusses relative risk. The inferences that can be made from these different study designs are, again, that randomized controlled trials, we can make causal inferences. Cohorts, causal inferences are possible, but less reliable than randomized controlled trials. And in case control, we can only make association inferences. This corresponds to being able to compute the relative risk, where we can compute the risk of disease in one group compared to the risk and disease of the control group. So treatment versus control, or exposure versus non-exposure. So those can be computed in both the randomized controlled trial and cohort studies, but in case control studies, we can only compute the odds ratio, which estimates the relative risk. Randomized controlled trials are prospective, they look forward in time. Cohort studies are prospective with respect to the groupings that we form initially, but a study can be conducted with existing data. So in other words, we can use historical data to form groups from past data and then look forward in time to the present. So in a sense, a cohort can be prospective or retrospective, but it is prospective with respect to the groupings initially formed. And case control studies are retrospective. We start with existing known cases and their control counterparts, and we look back in time for whether they were exposed to a risk factor of interest. Observational or experimental, so randomized controlled trials are the experimental studies, and cohort and case control are only observational studies. A typical progression of studies looks like this. So we haven't discussed cross-sectional studies, but these are simple prevalence studies to get basically a baseline of how prevalent a disease or outcome is in a population. From these cross-sectional or prevalence studies, we can do case control studies, which form more specific hypotheses. And then from there, to get stronger evidence, we can perform cohort or randomized control trials. This progression of studies is not absolute. And as we already discussed, when we have a rare disease, we would not want to do cohort studies. We would prefer to do case control studies. And this progression corresponds to lower cost, lower labor, but weaker conclusions for cross-sectional and case control, to more costly and stronger conclusions with cohort studies and randomized controlled trials. And that concludes this video. Thank you for your attention.